much hearing from you.
Thank you very much. Oh, don't clap. You haven't heard what I'm going to say yet. Neil's given me this title. I've got to do 23 years in 20 minutes. And so I'm going to crack on. If you want to know what the theme is of what I'm saying today, it comes down to this. It comes down to doing trials right from the beginning. This is Doug Altman. You'll all recognize Doug. And Doug and I knew each other, and we agreed about some things and argued about others. And he wrote this brilliant paper about why the scandal, actually, of poor medical research back in the 1990s. And on the front of the Consort website, he says this: to maximize the benefit to society, you need not just to do research, but to do it well. And if you sleep through the rest, that's where we go. Now, I'm going to make my life harder, Neil, by starting not 23 years ago, but 75 years ago, when Henry Beecher came back from the war. He was a surgeon, and he wrote this wonderful paper in Annals of Surgery, which basically said that everything that we know or think we know about pain is completely wrong. Now, I like papers like that. And this was one. When I read it, I thought, well, people were doing this before I was born. And this is where modern pain science really begins. 6 years later, in 1953, Beecher, together with some other people, published this, probably the first modern randomized controlled trial, analgesic trial. It recognized the importance of placebo. It laid out the requirements for randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trials to be able to test analgesic effects. And importantly, as you can see in the title, it recognized the issue in pain research of responders and non-responders. And though I say that it's pain research, it's probably true right across most of what we do in medicine. And then there was almost an explosion of interest in doing pain research properly, pain trials, testing analgesics. You have people like Abe Sunshine, Ray Hood with Ada Rogers and Stan Wallenstein in New York, Lou Lasagna and Mitch Max, who refined the methodology of pain research through the latter part of the last century. They pioneered the how to do it properly issues in pain trials. They introduced the models for single-dose acute pain methods into regular use, which is a fantastic thing in and of itself. And they had many insights on pain and doing pain trials from some people who thought very, very deeply about what they were doing. And then we come on to PaPaS, because those of us in Oxford who are also interested in doing this decided that the best way in which we could sort out some of the continuing problems with pain trials was to do systematic and critical reviews. And this involved an organization like Cochrane to be able to do it. On the right there, you can see Phil Whiffen, who did an awful lot to make PaPaS happen and was our first, what sort of editor are you? Coordinating editor, I can never get that right. The lady there is Dawn Carroll, fantastic pain research nurse, whose organization abilities made much of what we use in PaPaS work. And on the left-hand side there, you've got Henry McQuay, who was professor of pain research at the time, who not only brought his deep insights into what we do about systematic reviews in pain and pain trials, but also was responsible in part as director of research and development of making Cochrane as a whole happen. I'm going to talk about five things: initial pain, whose pain, size, imputation, and averages, and show how important for pain, probably for other things as well, these can be. Lou Lasagna in 1962, that's 60 years ago, demonstrated the importance of initial pain to analgesic efficacy, to the measurement of analgesic efficacy in a paper in The Lancet. And he demonstrated you had to have 3 and 4 pains, that is moderate or severe pain, and if you didn't, you didn't have any sensitivity in your assay, central to doing analgesic assays. The other thing he did, I only recognized this again recently, was that he did the first Labe plot, essentially trying to do a meta-analysis there of 22 aspirin trials and was puzzled by the fact that they were all over the place. This problem of initial pain or pain of control is still with us today. This is a PaPaS review on ketamine for postoperative pain, perioperative ketamine for postoperative pain. It said ketamine wasn't much good, but although it had 82 trials and 5,000 patients, most of those trials had no pain in their controls. And only 14, that's 17%, did have pain in their controls. And you see those on the right-hand side. So where there is pain, ketamine works. Where there is not pain, well, you can't know whether ketamine works or not because there's not any pain. And yet, you can see 86% of the trials in this review were unable to answer the question they purported to ask. Then there's a question of who should measure the pain. Let me introduce you to my grandson, Rafe. You'll see the family resemblance in the hair. Rafe had a bad hand, and his teacher dissed this, and he was really cross about it. So we were having a conversation. Rafe, says I, who should measure the pain? And Rafe said, the person who's got it and doesn't want it, which seemed to me to be a fair answer. And actually, if you ask people with pain, and indeed people without pain, about the level of pain that they've got, or they think they've got, then you ask the professionals who are looking after them, the professionals come up with a much, much lower answer. This business of dissing is common. And the extent of that is huge. In fact, it's bigger than the most effective therapies that we've got. So if you want to cure pain, ask a professional to measure it. You see the disconnect here. This is a study done in Vienna in people with rheumatoid arthritis and their carers. The physicians overwhelmingly thought that swollen joint counts were important. The patients overwhelmingly thought the pain was important. A total disconnect between the two sides in this relationship. Richard Horton, the editor of The Lancet, likes having a rant. And he had a rant a few years ago. He said, much of the scientific literature, perhaps half, may simply be untrue. Afflicted by studies with small sample sizes, tiny effects, invalid exploratory analyses, and flagrant conflicts of interest, together with an obsession for pursuing fashionable trends of dubious importance, science has taken a turn towards darkness. And he's right. Much of what we look at these days is absolute complete rubbish. But small sizes really got him. And so they should. In perioperative medicine, we are plagued by small sizes. These are trials, about 200 and some odd trials, with 294 comparison groups from 8 Cochrane reviews. And you can see the sizes of the treatment groups. Overwhelmingly, they're below 30 patients. There's none with more than 100 patients. So the way that one can look at this is that the ones below 50 are at high risk of bias, and the ones below 50 and 100 are at unclear risk of bias. The reality is, I think, that all of these are probably at high risk of bias for something or another, as well as small size, which makes it dubious as to whether we can say anything about them. But this is all of the trials in those 8 Cochrane reviews. And we know that small size, from this study and others, confers a larger treatment effect than large studies. Here we're looking at osteoarthritis, a whole range of studies, a beautiful paper in the BMJ in 2010, and it shows that those trials with fewer than 100 patients per treatment group had a larger treatment effect size than those in larger studies. Small sizes bedevil our research. And there are all sorts of little technical issues, you know, little technical issues like imputation. What do you do when somebody drops out of a trial? Well, the conventional way has been for decades to use something called the last observation carried forward. That is, you take the pain measurement when somebody drops out and carry it towards the end of the trial as if they were still in the trial, even though that might be months difference in time. If you do that, as here in a large data set for tapentadol and oxycodone, two different sorts of opioids, What you find in blue is both of them are better than placebo, significantly better than placebo. If you do the traditional way of doing it, that is say, well, if you're not taking the tablet, you can't get pain relief, and take the baseline observation when they drop out and carry that forward, what you find is that tapentadol is still analgesic, but is to a lesser effect, still significantly positive. Oxycodone is significantly worse than placebo. But then 60% of the patients taking oxycodone for 3 to 6 months or longer have withdrawn after about 6 to 8 weeks. What do patients want? Well, they obviously want to be better, but they want to be got rid of pain altogether. You ask any audience, I could do it to you now, but any audience around the world, you say, imagine the worst pain you've ever had, and you know, what would you like me to do? And the answers are, one, get rid of the pain. When do you want me to get rid of the pain? Now. It's what we want. We don't want average results. And yet, average results are often the only thing we have to go on. If you look at any pain with any treatment, and you've got enough good quality data, you get this pattern. You see, with postoperative pain, osteoarthritis, low back pain, painful diabetic neuropathy, at the top there are the people who are getting more than 50% pain relief, and that's the result that you want. And down the bottom are those who are getting very little pain relief at all, and the average is in the middle. In other words, the average is the place where nobody is, which is the problem with averages. You can see it here as well. Often used in many trials is the issue of is the outcome of analgesic consumption. Well, here we are, looking at about 900 postoperative patients in randomized trials, and looks at their opioid consumption. Is that a normal distribution? No, it isn't. If you ask them what's the mean, what's the median, and what's the mode, they're all different from one another. How do you report that data? Well, I don't know. I still haven't got a good answer for you. I don't know what would be an acceptable opioid consumption postoperatively. But there we go. That's what we've got if we're trying to look at much perioperative medicine. All of that is pretty negative, really, but I'm going to talk positively for a bit, even though this looks negative. Because I want to talk positively, really, a lot about Cochrane and the methods. These are 13 overviews of interventions for pain, overview reviews of systematic reviews. 323 included systematic reviews there, and we looked at them with AMSTAR. And when you look at them with AMSTAR, what you find is that almost all of these trials are critically low confidence or low confidence. In other words, you can't trust them. The methods are terrible. Some are moderate and high, and almost all of the Cochrane reviews are in there. And indeed, one of the great things for PaPaS is everywhere we look, almost all of the reviews have moderate or high confidence because they tick all the boxes. And I think that's a really important thing. But all the journals out there that are publishing systematic review are publishing often utter rubbish. Cochrane is really important that it carries on doing what it does. The problem with Cochrane and all the other systematic reviews are the trials in them. Now, Mike Clark, as you know, was the UK director of the Cochrane collaboration for many years. And Mike and his team, now in Belfast, published a lovely paper in Trials earlier this year looking at the risks of bias in 1,640 RCTs in 96 Cochrane reviews, and that's in blue there. So 62% had at least one high risk of bias, and 30% had at least one uncertain risk of bias, leaving 8% with no obvious, you know, which were green across the board, which were low risk of bias across the board, which were trustworthy. He called those with high risk of bias bad trials. We've looked at a pile of fibromyalgia reviews from PaPaS and this single ketamine review in PaPaS, and the situation is worse. You know, so many of our trials are at high or uncertain risk of bias, and very, very few have no risks of bias at all. The amount of good evidence from trials that we've got on which to base our results is extremely limited. And we need protection from zombie trials. The issue of fraud, I know other people are going to speak about today, but let me just take a moment to talk about John Carlyle, who is a hero. He's an anaesthetist in Torbay. He was the man who outed a Japanese chap called Fuji, who has to date had about 180 randomized trials in the anaesthetic literature retracted. Go and look at the Retraction Watch leaderboard if you want to know more about it. And John fingered him by doing some interesting statistical analysis on various aspects of the results. And he's now an editor of Anesthesia, and he started doing the same thing for all randomized control trials submitted to Anesthesia. And he found that in yellow, some of them were false. That is, they just weren't right for one reason or another in their statistics or the sorts of data that they purported to have there. But some of those, about half, he calls zombie. That is, it was so unlikely what they were reporting that it would have been more likely to have won the lottery. And so he said, well, this is worrying, and we're doing this from what they submit. Let's ask them for spreadsheets of their data. When he did that, it went up to 40% false and 25% zombie. That means these are being fabricated. It's astonishing. And John Ioannidis, who most of you will have heard of, did some calculations on the back of this in an accompanying editorial and reckoned there were probably hundreds of thousands of zombie trials out there. And if you can't spot them, which often we cannot, they pollute our systematic reviews and our evidence base. So some of us, Emma and Chris and Arthur, all got together and we decided that we were so fed up with this, we had a rant of our own. This paper is due out in the British Journal of Anesthetics in January. You can go onto the website right now until December the 28th and get a free download of it. And what we've done there is just to look at the most egregious of the problems that are there. And they are indeed many. This is a worrying time. We are looking and finding much more fabricated data. We are looking and finding data that are too poor to even contemplate looking at. We're looking and finding huge risks of bias. We're looking at finding huge conflicts of interest out there. What we're seeing after we've done that is that we've got very little left. One of the reviewers of this said it's a very bleak paper. And indeed it is, it's a very bleak paper. It didn't give me any joy at all in writing it with Chris and Emma because it is so, so negative. But sometime or another, you've actually got to sit down, recognize that you're in a hole and you've got to stop digging. Now, inside PaPaS, you can go to certain areas, put neuropathic pain up here because it's an important one. And you find that we've got 50 systematic reviews, good quality systematic reviews, but only 5 of those can tell you that we've got good evidence either that something works or something doesn't work. All of the others either have got no trials at all, nobody's done any research on it, they've got so few trials and so few patients that you can't even bother, just don't bother point in even looking at them. And for many others, there's maybe a small positive effect, but there's all sorts of biases there, and there's potential for significant publication bias that you can't trust the results anyway. And although there are 45,000 patients, they're not all in these trials, over half of those, well over half of them, are in topics where you might as well not have bothered. This is a huge amount of research waste, and it's expensive. If you just use even some, you know, very conservative figures as to what's happening here. These are billions of dollars and pounds and euros which are just gone to waste, as well as the ethical issues. And one of the things that, looking at those bad clinical trials, you know, you do calculations, other people are doing this. One of the calculations was with the bad trials, if we just put even the most conservative results on it, you'd run something like the NIHR for 10 to 100 years, just in terms of the wasted money that is there. There's good news. Again, in neuropathic pain. I knew you'd be happy with that. Things are getting better. So nonafinirip, in her big review of neuropathic pain in 2018, looked at the number of trials over time that were, for example, reporting intention to treat analyses or were reporting useful outcomes like 30% and 50% pain reduction or were of sufficient quality that they got an Oxford quality score of 5. And you can see in the upper left-hand pane there that those are getting better with time. And that's mainly due to the fact that what we're seeing is a lot of pharmaceutical company trials which are large and properly done. There might be other things about them we don't like, but they're large and properly done, which has made that happen. And the bottom right pane emphasizes again that where you haven't got an ITT analysis, where you're not reporting decent outcomes, where you've got no quality at all, what you get are NNTs of 1 to 3. You know, that's fantastic stuff. Huge effect sizes. Where you've got all those, actually, they're a lot more modest, much, much more modest. Quality is important. Otherwise, we make mistakes. And then there's spin. That is, looking at an abstract and believing that that abstract tells you what you want to know. The answer is that they don't very often. With a group of people, so many of whom are in this room, we put together a little instrument for measuring spin, and it comes up with an overall narrative bias score, and 2 and 3 shows you those which are moderate or severe spin for either efficacy or safety. And what that shows is that about 1 in 5 abstracts are spun. They're telling you things in an abstract which is unsupported by the data in a paper. No Cochrane review that is in there had any spin at all. It's fantastic. It's another, you know, benefit in Cochrane reviews and PaPaS reviews. So this is the last slide. What we've got to do is to raise the bar on clinical trials, and that's the highest bar I could find. We've got to do trials right from the beginning. For 75 years, we've learned about good quality trials in pain. We actually know how to do it. Most of them are just not done properly. We know how to do good quality systematic reviews. And there's a little way to go, I think, but you know, we're pretty much there. We know a lot about outcomes that are valued by patients, how that impacts on quality of life and work and a whole host of other things. But most of the trials are too poor to answer the questions we want answered. So trust and integrity with pain evidence stands and falls with the quality and the integrity of the trials that we've got to work with. They're rubbish. It's time we did some good ones. It really is. Thanks a lot.
Yes, there is an online question. So I'm going to read it out from here. Has Cochrane ever considered being more systematic and proactive about prescribing better trials? For example, using a review full of bad trials to generate a protocol for a trial which would answer the research question properly. These protocols or research prescriptions could be sent to funders who could then commission the trials.
That's an excellent point. Should we not set out how to do with trials, you know, a little go-to place?